on the standards. The presentation that you saw, we do have them in both languages. And we also have presentation on the web content accessibility guideline requirements. So normally what we were going to do is to present the requirements, the technical requirements on accessibility, so you can have them and know how to implement them. But if there's only one developer here, so what I do believe is that you will get those presentations and we can talk through what are your expectations on accessibility and what are the body of knowledge that you would like to have on accessibility. We can invent on other matters as well, but since we have to talk about accessibility, we will just try to focus on what is the information that you need to know on accessibility. And myself, as well as Shadi, will try to solve all the answers, all the questions that you have on digital content and web accessibility. And you will have the technical also presentation. So if that's okay with you, we can proceed like that. Will be less translation and more, since Shadi speaks, of course, he's Egyptian and speak fluently your language, Arab. You can be free to speak in Arab, and Shadi will translate to me if I can be of any use. So I don't know if that's okay for you guys. We can proceed like that. Also, another issue is lunch. Normally we took a long coffee break. We started a little bit later than was expected on the schedule. So lunch, I think, is already there for us. So why don't we have a couple of sandwiches? We have lunch. We can start working and talking on accessibility. I will be going to present myself and to ask you personally what are your expectations on the workshop and what you would like to know while we were having lunch. Then we can come together and work on those expectations and solve all those questions together. I don't know if that's okay with you. Is it okay also with the translator? Do you think that would be a good way to go? So thank you for the trust, because I know that I'm making your life much harder to follow that kind of model instead of a presentation model. But if it's okay for you guys, so why don't we go again outside, have a sandwich, and I will go to present myself and try to talk to you guys to see what are your expectations, what are you expecting from the workshop, and then we can, we take a short lunch, we take just 40 minutes, if that's okay for you guys, to have a sandwich, to talk a bit about what are your expectations on the workshop, and we come back here and we'll do our best, I will do my best with Shadi to solve all the questions that you have when you get to the workshop. So maybe it's something different, but I think it will be richer for all the participants and be reassured that you will have the presentation on the technical standards. So if that's okay with you guys, I invite you to go outside again, to have a sandwich, and I will be coming to talk to you guys to see what are your expectations and what are your big questions on web accessibility, so we can work together when we come back. Thank you very much. Thank you. So the idea of this afternoon workshop was to go through the requirements to have an accessible website. So I'm going to show you the slides that we have prepared, and then we're going to raise some questions to you in order to see what are you interested in and what are your expectations on the workshop. The reason why is I had the notion or the sensation that not all of you are web developers, and part of those slides can be a little bit technical. So I would like us to work together and try to solve as many questions as you have on web accessibility. So the web content accessibility guidelines, which are the guidelines that we introduced this morning, are guidelines that are based on four accessibility principles. The accessibility principles are the website need be perceivable, operable, robust, and adaptable. Those principles are looking or are trying to solve the problem that the website is compatible with any kind of assistive technology. The website is designed so any person can understand the content of the website. That is that if a person is blind, a person is deaf, a person has a cognitive disability, they can understand all the content that we are publishing on the internet. And why it is important? Because when we are trying to present or we are publishing or we are creating a website, at the end we want that everyone really get and understand what we are presenting in the website. Whether it's for e-commerce or for information or for whatever the purpose of the website is, we really want that everyone could do the interaction with the website that we're expecting, no? So the web content accessibility guidelines are designed in order to ensure that we have this equal access to accessibility. So what we have prepared for you for the afternoon is really going, that we saw in the morning, through all the requirements. For instance, the first requirement of the web content accessibility guidelines is that all non-tent contexts have an alternative text. And that we saw with Shadi in the morning as an example. Why every image needs to have an alternative text? Because if I'm a person with a visual disability, we had the right to get the same information. So if I put an image into a website, we need to have the alternative text so everyone had the same information. So I'm a person using a screen reader, we had the same information that the person without using the screen reader. So all the requirements that we included in this presentation that we have in both English and Arabic, and it's available for you, goes through all the requirements of the web content accessibility guidelines, explains you what the requirement is, and shows you how to implement it in code. So that's the presentation that we had for you. But now we have another proposition. Is you already have this. What are other questions that you may have on web accessibility? If you are interested in knowing all the requirements, we can go through the presentation, see the requirements, and explain them. We have close of 50 slides on requirements and how to implement them. So we can, that's one way to go, and we can implement, see all the presentation with the requirements. Or if you have more practical questions or issues you want us to discuss, this is the time to discuss it. I don't know, I'm going to pass the mic to Shadi to see if he wants to add something.
Dinner, maybe?
السؤال ايه رايكم؟ انا متهيألي افضل ان احنا نعملها ورك شوب نتكلم مع بعض ونشوف الاسئله اللي معاكم ولا تفضلوا ايه؟ ايه رايكم نبتدي we go around the room and everybody introduces themselves and ask you to say your name and what you do and what your interests are here in this workshop, what you would actually like to learn today, why you came here, and maybe we can then better adjust the information to your particular needs. I'll start here.
اسمع ليا. اخصائي مختلف في المنطقة. أستاذ الناس النهاردة حاجة كويسة إن هي تكون متاحة للناس كلها أو للأعضاء تكون حاجات سهلة تسهل للأعضاء يستعملوا صفحة النت. دي حاجة كويسة جدا إن إحنا نسهل للناس التصفح أو الدخول على صفحات النت.
Thank you very much.
وفاء سليمان معلم في التربية والتعليم عضو مجلس إدارة جمعية المستقبل المدفون بالإسماعيلية. وفي الحقيقة أنا بستخدم الإنترنت استخدام يومي فدايما بحاول أدور على أي حاجة تسهل ده. ف يعني أنا ما عنديش مشاكل كتيرة بس بتظهر مشاكل مع الاستعمال. فيمكن يكون نوصل مع بعض الحلول لمسألة الصور مثلا أو لأي حاجة أو يكون الاستخدام أبسط وأسهل منك. شكرا.
حسنة صالح خريجة لسانس ده الإنجليزي. يمكن هذا العرف الجديد عن تصميم المواقع وهيفيدنا في الفترة اللي جاية وكده.
أنا سمي اليمن وزارة الاتصالات وتقنية المعلومات موظف إداري. أتمنى أن يكون الورشة هذه تخرج إلى حيز التنفيذ ويستفيد منها ذوي الإعاقة والمفروض أنه يكون في التزمينات المعنية بهذا تكون مشاركة أكثر تعم الفائدة الجميلة. شكرا.
السلام عليكم. نوال إدريس محمد السودان مهندسة مسؤولة من ملف الأشخاص والإعاقة ومسؤولة من إدارة شؤون المستهلك. نحن نقوم في دورنا بوضع السياسات والأسس والمبادئ التي تسهل الوصول لخدمات الاتصال. الشيء البريد من هذه الورشة إنه أعرف كل الستاندر التي تتيح للأشخاص والإعاقة الخروج إلى شبكة الإنترنت بجانب القنوات المساعدة. سيستم تكنولوجيا.
عماد بودا سينيور أسيستم تكنولوجي سبيشاليست فيزيتنج فروم واشنطن دي سي. I'm a co-founder of United Resources, a non-profit organization based in Washington, and originally Egyptian, so glad to be here and see what's going on in implementing Section 508 of the American law in Egypt, and very exciting. And yeah, it's a lot of work. Also coming to see my friend Nabil.
أنا هنا بعمل من الجامعة الأمريكية عمل سوفت وير ديفلوبر. يعني عملت ويب سايتس قبل كده بس ما كانش فيها it was not a priority to make it accessible. So I'd like to learn more about how to make it.
أنا اسمي محمد سليمان رئيس جمعية فرسان الحياة لتنمية مجتمع المحبوبين بالغربية. اهتمامي طبعا بقضية المحبوبين أو الأشخاص ذوي الإعاقة. من أهم الأهداف اللي أنا شايفها النهاردة في المؤتمر بتاع النهاردة إن هو أهميته إنه بيفتح سوق عمل جديد من خلال التسويق من خلال شبكات الإنترنت وبيوسع مجال الثقافة للمحبوبين من خلال شبكات الإنترنت. ويا ريت ده يتحط على البوصة دي يتحط على قوائم الأهمية للدول والحكومات إنها تهتم بالقضية.
نبيل عيد عمل حاليا استشاري مع الاتحاد الدولي للاتصالات بخصوص تكنولوجيا المساعدة وتكنولوجيا الوصول من خلال في منطقة الشرق الأوسط وشمال أفريقيا. طبعا عملت مع الدكتوره مونيكا الاعلامي برنامج باللغه العربيه اشتغلنا عليه، يعتبر من اهم البرامج حقيقه حاليا ببدايه العام 2017 للوصول الى الاهداف النهائيه، وبالتالي الوصول الى 2020 في تحقيق ملاليه الوصول للاشخاص ذوي الاعاقه في المنطقه العربيه، وتحقيق ما يسمى بالتصميم العربي الشامل حيث يحقق التنوع البشري وامكانيه ايجاد بيئه تمكينيه لنفاذ كافه الاشخاص ذوي الاعاقه الى مواقع الويب والى المحتوى الالكتروني.
Thank you very much. So thank you, and now I feel like we know us a little bit better, so it makes the workshop much more interesting and much more humane. So from what I heard, we have a little bit of everything. We have the need of like a, how do we implement, or what are the benefits of web accessibility to really foster social and economic development of persons with disability. Like through accessible website, we can find more education opportunities, job opportunities, etc. for the end user, which are, of course, the benefits of all those policies, persons with disabilities. On the other hand, we have from the government point of view, what are the standards and what are the implementation and strategies to really boost and foster the right of digital accessibility, so we can discuss a little bit of standards and what are the best case experience that we have seen around the world in order to really create an ecosystem and foster standards that will at the end lead us to digital accessibility. And then the more technical part, that what are the standards and how do we implement for really getting at the end having accessible websites. So do you agree with me that we can go? So I will let I will talk about my experience in how digital accessibility is fostering and really boosting development of persons with disabilities in Mexico, Latin America, and a little bit in the state. That was what I've been working with. Then Shani can talk about a bit about standards and how he's seen, because he is an expert on standards and he really can tell us what he's experiencing, the implementation of the standards and the result that he's seen around the world. And then we can talk more technical parts on what web accessibility is and the requirements are, if you agree. So a bit of web accessibility. I know when we're talking about digital accessibility, we encountered the problem that yes, we do have inclusive accessibility, but we also need to have strategies in order to get the end user to have the computer, the access to internet, so that we really can use the web to develop economic and social activities. So we're not going to discuss connectivity in this workshop. This is for another workshop. But it is true that when we're talking about fostering digital and economic development of any person through the use of the internet, we need access to internet. No? So that's also, it's a question that is raised in a lot of forums, because in countries like ours, or in Mexico and Latin America, it is true that we do not have connectivity through all the national territory. So we do have a global problem that even though we're talking about how the use of internet can really help in the economic and social development of the persons, we need to have access to internet. No? So that's another problem that we're not going to discuss in this forum. But what we have seen and the opportunities that I have seen that we can, persons with disability can get through accessible and digital environments. Work office. We have in Latin America a network of job offers that are posted online and that are targeting persons, professionals, with or without disabilities that are looking for home office. So it's a very interesting application that will foster the economic development of persons with disabilities if in one hand we have a media of communication where we can look for jobs online. Of course, this platform should be accessible so everyone can really look at the jobs that are offered online. But the person that are posting the job descriptions are expecting home office. So, and I don't want to stress enough that the benefits from digital accessibility are benefits for all. Because even though, and I'm new in Egypt, but I had the sense that traffic is terrible here. So I also have the sense that you can really take 2 or 3 hours to arrive to your workplace. If these 2 or 3 hours can be spent in home office, I do believe that our productivity will be better for everyone. So those kind of strategies, those kind of initiatives really helps the whole society, the society as a whole, I'm going to say. No? Another super important issue that helps us all through digital accessibility is health. All the e-solutions and e-health need to be offered in accessible platforms because all the consumers of information of services of health services through the internet, online services, all those services needs to be accessible. So I really want to stress the three important areas, which is labor, health, and education. Finally, education. We seen in the United States a very renowned case where I think it was the Association of Deaf People that sued MIT and Harvard because some of their online courses were not accessible. And this is where the right of any person who needs or who wants to get educated need to be put in place. Anyone, if we have an online course available, it needs to be accessible for everyone because we cannot really discriminate in education for anyone. So that's the three main areas where we really have to stress on digital accessibility. The fourth one, which is also important, is government. And a very used example in Mexico is organizations of the blind in Mexico are pushing to be extended to pay taxes because the only platform in Mexico to pay taxes is through an online platform. If this online platform is not accessible and I'm a blind person and I cannot access to pay my taxes, so ergo I should be extended to pay taxes, no? So government, health, education, and labor should be the first areas that we have to really push our policies, our efforts to make them available in accessible platforms so we can really foster digital, social and economic environment of everyone in our country. You want to say something? No? Any questions so far? So those are the some of the examples and the areas that we can really work on to push social and economic development. I would like to start discussing, if you want, a little bit of standards. What are the best practices and what are the experiences that you've seen around the world that really help only in implement a law or a policy on digital accessibility? And what are the best results that you have seen in your experience?
Okay, so I understand the situation here in Egypt that we don't yet have the same policy framework that will allow the enforcement of requirements as is needed. Even though Egypt has actually ratified the UN Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disability, which I think is a major aspect, so there is a responsibility of the government to act on these aspects, on these issues. So that's one side of the coin that we need to push for these rights to be actually implemented in practice. But coming at it from a very different perspective, I think developers are not very excited by policy requirements and enforcement. They may be more excited by the challenges. And what problems can I do to solve So we had the colleague in the back who was saying she created websites, has not before considered accessibility, but maybe you have considered mobile requirements to make the optimize your website for mobile design. Or maybe you've considered your website to work on particular or different types of browsers and operating system. So automatically, you may have already done a lot of accessibility without knowing so. You may have already looked at usability and user experience. That's already half the piece in accessibility is the usability aspects of how well is the website designed, how well do you communicate your information. So what I'm trying to say is achieving the standards can be from multiple ways, and accessibility sometimes seems like it's something separate, it's something different, but think of it when you're building the house. The best accessibility, the most accessible houses, are ones where you actually don't even see accessibility, because the ramp is integrated in the design of the building from the beginning. The doors have already been concepted to be large enough. All these aspects, and the same with the creation of websites and apps, when you are from the beginning, or actually any ICT for that matter, when you're using a user-centered design model, when you are asking the developers to think about the users first, who are their audiences, and to think about the quality, how they are approaching the development, then you already end up with something that has a high user experience. That's a buzzword in the development scene, user experience. And that's also already half the way to accessibility. So we can approach the standards from a more practical, from a more inviting perspective. We were just talking about that at lunch. You may need to speak different languages with different audiences. With the developers, it's more this aspects of the technical challenges and how to approach these, how accessibility will actually benefit the quality of your website, make it work on more devices, on more browsers, be more robust. And maybe for the managers, it needs to be more in terms of business case arguments. What's the return on investment? And we've shown earlier this morning that there are return on investments. And to the higher level policymakers, it needs to be a matter of right, a matter of established policies and things that need to be done. These are things that countries have claimed responsibility for in the UN Convention, and they need to come through with the implementation of that.
Thank you very much. Any questions so far? Okay. I'm going to go through the standards. So, we talk about the importance of the standards, we talk about the web content accessibility, the different standards that you can find, and we talked a little bit about web content accessibility guidance. So, from also as a member of the government, you really need to get a procurement policy that includes all these issues on accessibility. If us as government include the obligation of buying and having accessible website, then the provider to the government will need to comply with the standards of accessibility. That's the one.
Perfect.
So, we're going to continue. Hopefully, we answered some of the questions that you have, and I'll go through the technical standards. So we're going to see the requirements and how to implement the requirements, and we're talking here of the web content accessibility guidance from a level A, and in some cases I will show you the level AA. How the standards are developed is we have a set of requirements, and those requirements, the standard tells us how to meet the requirements. No? Then if we have some time later on, we can see how to validate and test the standard. So the first standards are related to the principle perceivable, which is all the content that we're going to put on our website need to be perceived by everyone. So the first requirement is to have alternative tests for all non-text content. So all the images, we were talking about images just a second ago, all the images need to have an alternative text. So when in code we are putting the tag IMG, we need to have an alternative text for explaining what is inside the image. What we can see in reality is there's a lot of automatic validation of alternative text. So it is the responsibility of the content creator to put alternative text that makes sense. So what we try to communicate through the image, this is the core of the text that we need to put in the alternative text, no? What happened if, as a designer, we put images that are merely for decoration? When a person is going through a website with the use of an assistive technology, for instance, a person who is blind that is using a screen reader in order to get and understand the content of the website, and we have decorative images, we can put an alternative text blank because we do not need to understand what is the content of the alternative image. No, it's something purely for decoration. So that's part of the requirements. Also, when we have a link, we need to put a text description of what the link is. A lot of times the designers of a website assume that if we put the image of a bird, everyone will understand that we have a link to Twitter. Well, we need to put a description of the link, of every link that we put in a web page, so it's really understandable and perceivable for all. And I will give you the presentation so you have all the examples. What happened with the complex images or complex graphs? When we use a graph or an image to communicate an information and it's very complex, we need to put a link that explains the content of the graph or the content of the text. No? Do never assume that everyone is seeing the information that we are posting. Always assume that people are not seeing the information that we are posting and that people are not navigating with the use of a mouse. If we assume those two principal things, that we're not seeing the information and that we're not using a mouse, that we are surfing the net with the use of the keyboard, big problems of accessibility will be solved. So when we're putting a graph, or when we're putting a complex graph or a complex image and we're posting it as a content on a website, it is very important to include a link that explains the content of the information. What happened when we are creating a form that are expecting of the user to put some data? When we're putting forms, every entry of data should have an access and should have associate labels. Always the same. Do not assume that people are saying. So we need a label that explains what are we expecting of the data. That's part of the requirements. If you have any questions, please stop me and we can check it also. The buttons on the form should have descriptive values. What we have a lot in a lot of websites, we have this icon. So when they put a little shape of search, and we assume that people know that when we get to these kind of buttons, it's a search engine. But a lot of people do not understand what this symbol means. So when we are putting some buttons, it is very important to put the value, descriptive value of the button, so everyone understands what we're talking about. The frames and iframes will have a proper title. We need to put titles in everything when we're creating a website. And I'm going through all the requirements, but really the solution is headers and titles for all the websites. So one of the requirements is when we put a frame or an iframe, do not assume that people are understand what the frame or the iframe, the content is for. We always need to put relative titles to the iframes. What happens with all our multimedia content? We saw it in this morning's presentation. When we have a multimedia content online, the requirements ask us to have closed caption and description of the content of the multimedia. So one of the requirements is a transcription is available for pre-recorded audio only. If we're going to put some audio online, we need to put a pre-record content of the audio. That's part of the requirements. When we're publishing a pre-recorded or synchronized video and audio, we need also to have the description and the subtitles of the content. Example caption. So what we were talking about media, and we were talking about those also about social platforms like YouTube. In YouTube, you can have a function that will include the closed caption to all your multimedia and all your video contents. Another requirement is when for base time media or audio description of the pre-recorded video content is provided for synchronized media, except we need to include the audio description of the pre-recorded videos that we're putting online. And that's part of the example that we saw earlier on with Mr. Shaggy's presentation. So audio description is also part of the requirement of multimedia content. What is with live audio and live video? The requirements ask us to have live audio content description. So if this were a meeting that we wanted to be complied with the requirements of the W3C in the level AA, we would need all the presentation to have closed captions, live closed caption on everything that we are talking about. Audio description, and we saw the difference of the video later on. One thing is captioning, and another thing is the audio description. So both of the requirements are included in the Web Content Accessibility Guidelines, that in a level A, we need only the subtitles. In a level AAA of compliance of accessibility, we need also to include the audio description. In a level AAA of compliance of the standards, they will ask us to have the translation in sign language. So you can understand how the level of compliance of the level accessibility included in the guidelines goes from less, for instance, for video. If we were going to post some video online, we only needed the captions in order to comply with a level A of accessibility. With a level AA, we need the caption and the audio description. And for a level AAA, we will need the translation in line languages. The best practice around the world is for governments at least to comply with a level AA level of compliance for their websites. What happened with information like the CAPTCHA? No, CAPTCHA normally is something, it's a component that is used in web development to ensure that you are not a robot and the person who is interacting with the website is human. There are CAPTCHAs that are accessible and there are CAPTCHAs that are not accessible for anyone. I'm not just talking of person with specific needs, but CAPTCHAs are very important to be accessible. So part of the requirement is that when we're using that kind of component, we also offered an adapted different senses should be offered, no? Not only with the site, but different senses could be used for the CAPTCHAs. and we will give you the presentation with some of the examples. Another important requirement is that when the sequence in which content is presented affects its meanings, a correct reading sequence can be programmatically determined. What happens with headers? And like the example that Mr. Shady gave this morning, when we're reading a newspaper, normally what we read first is the headers, and then we go to the information that we're really interested in. The same happens for this requirement on web accessibility. Some of the assistive technology, we can ask as user to give me the headers of the website. And that way I can go directly to the information that I'm interested in. So it is very important when we're developing a website to use the header correctly and to use the headers in an intuitive and correct manner. Some of the errors of accessibility that we see is some developers use the headers to do some for editing purposes and for design purposes, because if I use an H1, it will be, the font will be bigger than if I use another kind of header. And they use the header just for design purposes. Avoid that awful mistake from further on. Use the header in order to give you some structure to your development. Also the same happens to the charts. It is very important when we're putting a chart, when we're creating a chart, to give them the associated headers, which is which one is data and which one is header, because the assistive technology is compatible with that kind of label and will read us the table in a correct manner. So if I use correctly the associated headers to the all the cells on my table, the user and will have the correct information of what we're trying to communicate. At the end, the guidelines, what they're trying to do is everyone have access of the same information. Everyone have access to the same information. So if we're using a table to communicate and to give information to anyone, we have the responsibility to have a correct and ordered table where the associated headers, we have D for data, TH for headers, to have the associated header, the correct associated headers in all the cells of our table, so everyone can understand the chart in the same manner. The elements included in forms are related through field sets and legends, and this is also very important. In every website, we have forms that the user need to fill. When we need to fill a form, normally what some of the developers use tables just for giving some format to the forms. Do not use charts for formats and for forms, and also use field set and legend. Every cell need to be associated with a legend. I need to know what is the information that you expected me to put in any kind of format or forms. The use of colors. I don't know why more in men than in women, but 3 out of 11 men are colorblind. So when you're designing a website, it is very important to avoid the use of colors or the only use of color to present some information. Why? Because some of 3 out of 11 person won't understand the information that we're trying to present. So do not use colors as the only mean of communication. And it happens a lot of websites. When you're scrolling in a website and you arrive to a link, normally what is usually done, the link colors as blue. So now you assume that everybody knows that you arrived to a link. One, if I'm colorblind, I didn't saw the change in color. So I don't really understood that arrive in a link. So it is very important that besides color, we use another alternative form. So we have not only color, but we have also the box, for instance, to understand that we have an alternative form. And the same happens when we try to communicate. When we try to communicate, for instance, in this pie graph chart in form of pie, if we put the information inside the graph, the colorblind person won't understand the information. So the correct way to present a chart is to put beside the form the text of the information that we're trying to communicate. The same happens with additional use instead of color. For instance, here in the example, we arrived in a link, and the link is not only changing in color, but also it's going to be underlined, so the person really understands that I'm arriving at a component that they're expecting something from the user. If an audio plays automatically, and we have seen this more and more often, that you arrive to a website and the audio start running automatically, the accessible way is offering a way of pausing the audio. If I'm a person that I have difficulty understanding, or I'm a person that the noise can really distract me and I'm really losing focus on the information that I'm trying to understand, it is very important that we include a way for the user to stop the audio of any web page that plays automatically. Another requirement is for caption and image of text can be resized without assistive technology up to 200%. What happens when we're designing, and that's a challenge for designers. When I'm designing a website, I can be able to change the size up to 200% without losing the information of the web page, without losing its context. And this happens for everyone. Anyone who's now using a smartphone, me, for instance, that have a problem of vision, I use an enlarged font. We have to be able to enlarge to up to 200% the font without losing the context of the web page in order it to be accessible and meet this requirement. Another requirement, and it has to be with operability of the website, is all functionality of the content is operable through keyboard. And that's what the two tips that I was talking about earlier on. We need to, when you're designing a website, assume that the user do not use a mouse. So I have to be able to get and to reach every part of the website using the keyboard. And not only being able to access every part of the website using the keyboard, but do not lose myself when I arrive to a specific place in the website. So when you are designing, part of the requirement is all functionality of the content is operable through a keyboard interface. And that's super important because a lot of persons are not surfing the net with the use of a mouse. Another requirement is, it is not recommended when we have, for security reasons, some of our website needs to have some time limitation. When we're doing your banking online, there's a time limitation. After certain amount of time, you have to restart the action, or the website will take you away from the page that you were in. The accessibility requirements ask you to always inform the user how much time do I have to perform the action. So if I was, for instance, in my banking web page of my banking account, and I'm trying to do some actions in the banking account, it is very important that that I am informed as a user how much time do I have in order to be complete the action that is expected from me. As well as the automatic audio, we have the same for the carousels. Sometimes now it's very fashion that when we enter some web page, we have a carousel that automatically starts running. The accessibility requirement asks us to offer the user the possibility to stop this movement within the website. So the requirement is for any moving or blinking scrolling information that starts automatically, we need to have the possibility to pause it or stop it whenever we are interested in. Another requirement is for any auto-updating information that starts automatically, it's presented in parallel for each with other content, there is a mechanism also to stop. So some of the times, and it's very common to get to be in our web page or information is auto-updating automatically, we need to offer the user the possibility to stop this information, because maybe I need sometimes to realize and understand the first information when it's automatically updated. So it is very important to offer the user all the possibilities to really understand the information. Web content should not move when the user is moving the mouse or the pointer. And also, all the dynamics of the movement and all the elements that are very dynamic in a website, preferably, we recommend not to use them because it's very distracting for the end user. So it is as a requirement to not move other objects while the user is surfing in the internet, in the website. The requirement of avoiding seizures. Web page do not contain anything that flashes more than 3 times in any 1 second period. All the flashings, and it's very common, and I do not believe that a lot of people or a lot of designers use that, but we have to avoid the use of flashes more than 3 times in a second because it is have been proved that it can create some seizures if we can see that in a web page. Another requirement is all the web page have titles that describes topic or purpose. A common mistake that we all use, and it's not only on web page, we also used to do that kind of mistake when we're creating documents. You create a document and then you put a title in the document that at that moment makes sense, but then later on in the day when you're trying to reconsult that document, we do not remember the title of the document. So please try always to put some title that describes the topic of the purpose of the document or the web page. Because persons that are using a screen reader, they need the screen reader to really read the description of the topic that you are navigating on. A mechanism is available to bypass blocks or content that are repeated on multiple web pages. A lot of people that are using assistive technology, the assistive technology goes through all the elements of a web page. So if we're repeating elements of a web page, we can use some bypass blocks in order to help the person to skip some of the blocks that are repeated, so we don't have to go over and over and over of those contents. The same happens with headings and labels describe the topic of purpose. Some of the headings, really the content of the title of the label do not really describe the purpose of the information. Everything is about the information we're trying to communicate. And it's a challenge, it's an order exercise. But once we are used to do things orderly and in an intuitive manner, it really won't take you a lot of time to grab it. So if we do it, for instance, using H1 as a label, as a heading, put really the title of the H1 label. So use the headings and the label that describe really the topics and the purpose of the information that you are presenting. Language also, we assume that the content is written in a certain language, it is very important that we add the lang attribute to the content. So the assistive technology understands in which language they're or which intonation they're going to use, it's going to use to read to the user. So it is part of the requirement that the language of the page should be identified using the attribute lang. So the assistive technology understands what is the language that we are working on And for multi-language sites, the language option should be presented clear in image and or text. If we have a web page, and it happens with a lot of web pages that it's in various languages, it has to be, the requirement is that it has to be very clear where the language options are with an image and a text. Now we have, as we've seen earlier, we have to include both the image and the text. And I know I don't have the clicker for the Arab version, but it is important. Will you have both? No change in context should be initiated in the page when any component receives its focus. Any component of the interface that unlikes an event upon receiving focus should not alter the context. It is very important when we're trying to, for appearances of web page that operates and navigates are predictable, we need to be consistent through all our designs. So when we use a pattern, try to maintain the pattern through all the design, because it is important that we maintain the same structure. For instance, button at the beginning of the site indicated different language options should always be at the same place. So try to maintain the same patterns with through all the website, so the user that understood my landing page can understand the rest of the content and the rest of the pages of my website. Browsing mechanisms repeated in multiple pages appearing in the same relative order. And it's the same, it's related to the requirement, the previous requirement that you just saw. We need to maintain the same patterns through all our design, so people can really, once they understood my design, really go through all the information of my website without any problems. Offer instruction or tags when input is required from the user. It's a requirement, but a requirement that benefits all. When you have, you're doing, you're filling up a form online and you have mistaken or you did something wrong, it is very important that we have instructions and very clear tags on what we have to do in that specific form, what is expected from the user. So clearly identify the required fields, such as a date field specifying the correct format of the date, the correct format of the name and last name. It is very important to be clear on what is the expectations that you have. You know what the... So as you can see, even though we're going very, very quickly through all the requirements are designed, are there with this whole purpose that everyone gets the same information. Everyone gets the same information. So when you are developing a website and you are wanted it to be accessible, you need to think that not only the operating part of the website should be adaptable and accessible for any assistive technology. That is that if I am surfing through the website with the use of keyboard, with the use of any assistive technology, I can access to every corner of the website. That is the part, the operability part of the requirements, to be sure that everyone can get to any corner, every corner of the website using any kind of assistive technology or using the keyboard, but also the content that is posted on the website should be accessible for everyone. So that is part of the thing that we have to know and to think about when we are designing a website. So when we have a format, or when we we need some information from the user. It is very important that our instructions are intuitive and clearly stated, so every user really knows all the time what is expected from me in this requirement form or in this specific formula of the website. If I made an error while filling up a form in my website, it is important, it is a requirement that it is detected and validated and should be identified and notified to the user by test message to be corrected. There's so many websites that we make some mistakes while trying to fill up a form and we do not know where is my error. So the requirement is you need to be very clear and really show the user where the error is. And it's something that will help us everyone if when we're designing for a website and when we are expecting an interaction with the user, to be very clear of the instruction that the user need to follow. Also, when the user have a mistake, to be very clear where is the mistake that the user made. More and more we see website that will highlight the box where we made the mistake. That's the accessible way to do it. To really highlight it, the part of the formula or the part of the requirement that I missed, it is very important to highlight where did I make a mistake and what is the information that is expected from me. In content implemented using markup languages, elements must have complete start and end labels, and elements should be nested according to their specification. Elements should not contain duplicate attributes, and any ID should be unique. And it's more like, this is for developers. When we are creating our code, HTML code, we use and we recommend to use the W3C validator to see if we've made any mistakes. Sometimes we forget to put some to close a bracket or to close any, or we repeat some of the labels, and those kinds of errors maybe at a simple view won't make a difference, but they make a difference and they really can difficult the person that is navigating with assistive technology to do the what is expected from us. So it is very important to validate our code through the automatic validation to really look for those kinds of mistakes. For all user interface components, including but not limited to form elements, links, and components generated by scripts, the name and role can be programmatically determined. States, properties, and values that can be set by the user can be programmatically set. A notification of changes to these items are available to user agents, including assistive technologies. That's part of the compatibility that we need to think also about. As I was saying, there's two ways, or two things that we have to take into consideration when we are developing a website. The part of how to interact with assistive technologies, which is have to be with the way that we are surfing through the website. The website has to be intuitive, the colors have to be adequate, the contrast has to be good, we have to be able to enlarge the size. All those requirements need to be thought of, as well as the component, the content part of the requirements. So also for all user interface component, we need to be sure that they are compatible, including with assistive technologies. So, and you will have the information with the requirement, but once we have, if we are using, there was at lunch a question from the audience that what can we do if we're using platforms like WordPress or Drupal to develop a website. All those platforms now have accessibility consideration in them. So if we're using the latest version of WordPress or the latest version of Drupal, all those already have embedded in the in their core accessibility features. So the WordPress, for instance, do have accessible templates already in place. So part of those requirements that are technical requirements that are looked for operability and for compatibility with assistive technologies, some of those templates that we can find have already solved that kind of accessibility requirements. The other part of the equation is, well, now that I have an accessible and compatible website with assistive technologies, it is very important to maintain the content part of the information accessible. That is, that if we're uploading images to put the alternative text, if we're using decorative images to put all the requirements that I just explained, so you can really assess and be sure that the development of your website is accessible. And there are automatic tools to check the accessibility of your website. So some of the testing techniques is, and we recommend, is the use of a screen reader or to go through the website using keyboard. If I can go through my website using the keyboard and I can access every corner of the website, I'm on a good track of accessibility, and it's a very simple way of testing if I'm going in a good track or not. The same thing if I use a screen reader. There are free screen reader in and NVDA is very popular in Latin America, but most of VoiceOver for Apple, most of the operating systems offer a free screen reader. So if you can assess the accessibility of your website using a screen reader, it is very useful really to have a sense of the work that we've been doing. Also, there are automatic tools that checks the accessibility of your website. For instance, the web have a contrast checker, so you can use this automatic tool to check if the contrast of your information is the adequate or not, if it complies the requirements or not. As well as the gym catchers, it offers you also a view of your headers, and that's a very good way to check the accessibility of your website. Finally, we have in the W3C the automatic code validation. For the last requirement, it's important to see if we have some errors in our coding or not, or the CSS validation also offered by the W3C. At the end, the final user is the one who need to test, or we recommend that the final user test the accessibility of your website. We can have a website that already meeting all the requirements of accessibility, but at the end user can give us much more information and much more input on the usability, and Shani was also talking about usability of the website. There's a lot of companies and a lot of government developers' websites that are doing at the end of some user testing to see if the website is intuitive, if the user at the end can really use the website or not. We always recommend to use for user testing persons with disabilities, persons using assistive technology, because if your website can be navigated, can be understood, can be really, all the actions that are expected from the user are done by a person using assistive technology, then everyone can really use your website. So the invitation is, and the best practice are, that in every development of a website or in every user testing activity, always invite a person with disability, always invite a person using assistive technology to be this end user testing, to do this end user testing, to be this tester, because if a person using assistive technology, if a person with a disability really can have a good experience in the website, everyone could have a good experience in your website. I don't know if you have any questions so far. Any question? So at first this could sound like a lot of work, we have to think about all these requirements. There's so much work that needs to be done in order to have an accessible website. But it's a learning curve, and be assured that once you've done it one time, you can redo it with the half of the time invested in creating this accessible website. The also interesting part of the requirement is you do not need to have a specific or a specialized knowledge in order to be able to create accessible content and accessible website. But we've shown, and all of you that are programmers and developers will understand that the requirement that we just explained are very easy to comply. We just need to know them and try to comply them. But once we made an accessible website that maybe took us 10 hours to create, the second accessible website that we will make it in half of the time. And the same thing, and we're going to see that in the workshop tomorrow, but the same thing happens for all the content that we are creating. In our organizations, we normally work with digital documents, maybe in a Word format. Well, a document in a Word format also can be made accessible. And there's also part of these contents includes all the documents that we're doing in a Word format, for instance. When we're doing a document that we're putting an image on, we are able to put some alternative text in that image. And this simple principle that I'm telling you, tomorrow that you will go out to your offices and you will start working in digital format, because everyone now works in digital format, you will know every time that you put an image in a document, if you do not put an alternative text on that image, you will know that you've done something wrong. So it's something very easy to do, very easy to comply. And now that you know what the requirements are, we can really try to implement them in all the content that we're creating, so everyone can access to the information that we're doing and we are posting and publishing online. So tomorrow, another evaluation tool, we have also the web accessibility evaluation tool developed by WebIM, which is a very, very good tool, but because it will highlight where are the mistakes found of accessibility mistakes found within a URL, as well as the accessibility checker, and I will send you all the information so you can use these accessible and available free online checkers in order to see how accessible is your website. It is important to know the requirements, because those accessibility checkers have made some mistakes, no? For instance, when we're talking about images, those checkers will identify if the alt attribute is in the code when we have an image. But it is your responsibility to put a really good description of the image. But something that will happen, and a word that a false positive that we get that those automatic tools can give you, is they will identify the existence of the attribute alt for description of an image, but they don't have the artificial intelligence to really understand if the description that we put on is a correct description of the image. For instance, if I put the F, for the F logo of Facebook in my website, which is a link, and I put as an alternative text image instead of link to Facebook, that will be a false positive, because automatic validator will identify that I put a label to my link, but will not identify that the content of the label is the correct one or not. So that is why it's so important that we know what are the requirements are, we know what is the work that is expected for us to be done in order to really create, minimize the digital divide and create accessible content for all. And at the end, I was telling you, always invite the end user, always invite the person using assistive technology to do our testing, to access to our information, to see if really all the information that we're trying to communicate is accessible for everyone. I don't know if you have any questions so far.
Thank
So we have a list of emails of all the participants in this workshop. We will send you the presentation in Arabic where we had all the examples and the requirements. I do believe, Shadi, that W3C, we do have a version of the guidelines in Arabic, no?
Yes.
We will also give you the link of the versions in Arabic of the Web Content Accessibility Guidelines. As we were saying, this is the version 2. We're all, you, not me, but they're already working on the version 2.1, which includes a lot of mobile requirements for accessibility. But the good thing to know is an accessible website is a website that normally is responsive for different formats, which is very good. It's everything everyone is looking for nowadays, that the penetration of mobile internet is growing so fast in our countries. And also an important thing for the all of you very focused on marketing, digital marketing and positioning in search engines, a good website, an accessible website that have the correct labels and is organized, it has a very much better positioning in those search engines than a lousy and crappy non-accessible website. So even if it's a human right, even if it is an important step towards the digital inclusion, towards the development of everyone in a universal manner, think about it as a goal, a business goal, or marketing, a digital marketing goal. An accessible website is a less expensive website to maintain, and is a website that will be better positioned in a search engine. So if you are into e-commerce, or if you are a government agency, or if you have information that you want to share to the world and you want everyone to know about what you were informing and communicating, it is better to have it in an accessible website, because in the all those search engines will be much better positioned if it is an accessible website. You want something? I don't know if Karim want to add something or if you have any question. I mean, we have time. We still have time. I went through the requirements very quickly because most of you are not developers, and maybe part of those requirements are a little bit tedious. But the importance is to know that those requirements are designed for developers, for content creators, to really understand how everyone is surfing the net. That not everyone is surfing the net with the use of a mouse or with the use of their eyes, but a lot of us are surfing the net with use of assistive and alternative technologies. So they are designed really to include everyone in the internet. Yes. So we're going to see some of the example of good website, of crappy websites, non-accessible ones, so you can really see the difference in situ of what are the expected or the resultings of accessible website. And I would like also invite you to see how an accessible website do not sacrifice design. It is a very correct idea that if I'm programming an accessible website, it has to be very plain and we have to sacrifice design for accessibility, and it is not true. We understand that we are living in a digital world. We understand that everyone more and more is offering and is presenting information and content using the internet. So it is very important to see that you do not have to sacrifice design for accessibility. On the contrary, I dare you to see the difference of an accessible website to a non-accessible website when everything is done correctly in coding. So I will leave now Shadi to show you some of these examples and also how some of these automatic tools work so you can really understand how to validate and test the accessibility of a website.